Writer-director Darren Aronofsky is a filmmaker whose technical mastery has allowed him to tell visually and auditorily intense, hyper-subjective stories where viewers are pulled violently into a character's world through visceral sensory experience. It's a very common phenomena for a person to watch one of Aronofsky's films, to be completely devastated and horrified by the experience, and then to have little to no means of explaining how or why those intense emotional reactions came about. By looking through a more symbolic, psychological lens, I hope to bring a bit more of his work into focus. This analysis is my attempt to figure out what it is that Darren Aronofsky is up to. What sets Aronofsky apart from many other filmmakers is the way he weaves symbolism into his work. Permeating most of his films are references, both implicit and explicit, to ancient religious stories and myths. This is how Aronofsky manages to take contemporary stories and imbue them with the same fundamental inquiries about morality and the human soul that we have been attempting to answer since the beginning of time.
Their innocence is extinguished. And so for the 10 generations since Adam, sin has walked within us. Brother against brother. Nation against nation. Man against creation.
Human beings are captivated by narratives, whether fantastical or realistic, mystical or scientific, historical or futuristic, whatever the case may be. We gravitate towards stories because they tell us something about ourselves, something about our nature. We've been telling stories since the beginning of time, or at least as far back as our cultural memory will allow, what equates to tens of thousands of years. Those earliest, most rudimentary stories are what became the foundations of our worldwide mythological and cultural canon. In the West, the origin story of human beings begins with creation and with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. It's my view, and the view of many others, that the central theme of this particular story, in very rough, archaic language, is the process by which human beings evolved to possess consciousness. The phenomena of human consciousness is something that, to this day, we still don't really understand. Yet we're all aware of the fact that we are unique individuals, that we're mortal, that we feel pain and suffering, and, perhaps most importantly of all, that we possess intrinsic value. The basic Garden of Eden story appears to be very simple. God, after creating Adam and Eve, placed them in the Garden of Eden, a paradise. God tells them that they must not eat of the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. A serpent tempts Eve by telling her that if they eat of that fruit, they will be as gods, and will have their eyes opened. After eating the forbidden fruit, Adam and Eve are exiled from the garden and discover that they are naked, aware that they are vulnerable, aware of their own pain, suffering, and mortality. There are many different meaningful interpretations of this story and its characters, but the basic pattern that seems most important is that of man moving from a previously unconscious state to an increasingly conscious state. By partaking of the fruit of the tree of knowledge, man's eyes are opened and he becomes like a god. A side effect of this heightened awareness of self is the knowledge that man suffers, feels pain, and will eventually die.
The word for the Garden of Eden, Kedem. Numerical translation, 144. Now, the value of tree of knowledge, all right, in the garden, right? Eitz HaChayim, 233. 144, 233. Now you can take those numbers.
Like the Fibonacci sequence?
Fibonacci
is an Italian mathematician in the 13th century. If you divide 144 into 233, the result approaches theta.
Theta?
Theta. The Greek symbol for golden ratio, golden spiral.
Aronofsky's first film, Pi, centers around Max Cohen, a number theorist. Max's childhood encounter when he stared directly at the sun grants him the power of infinite mathematical knowledge, but he suffers from excruciating headaches as a result. In addition to Max's experience being a nod to the story of Icarus, who flew too close to the sun, this is the pattern that Adam and Eve follow in the Garden of Eden. That is, encountering something forbidden and being awakened as a consequence.
I was terrified, alone in that darkness. Slowly, daylight crept in through the bandages, and I could see.
Max spends the entire film in a linear pursuit of a kind of divine pattern that he believes can explain all of the order in the universe. Max is searching for a cure for his suffering, which is both physical and existential. He's trying to find a way back into the garden paradise. A similar narrative pattern occurs in The Fountain, which takes place across three storylines: the past, which is a fictional story being written by Izzy, the present, and the future, which seems to be some kind of metaphorical representation for Tommy's mind or spirit.
The Mayans called it Xibalba.
Xibalba?
It was their underworld. The place that dead souls go to be reborn.
What are you talking about?
My book. I'm writing about it.
I thought it took place in Spain.
Begins there. Ends there.
The present timeline we can interpret as reality, where Tommy Creo, a doctor, is attempting to find a cure for his wife Izzy, who has terminal cancer. Rather than spend his last days with his wife, Tommy busies himself with his work, desperately trying to find a cure. In a fictional timeline set in the 1500s during the Spanish Inquisition, Queen Isabel is surrounded on all sides by the forces of the Grand Inquisitor, who can be seen as a stand-in for her cancer in the present timeline. Queen Isabel instructs her bravest conquistador, Tomás, to go into the jungles of Central America to find what is believed to be the Tree of Life. And in the future timeline, we see him interacting with the Tree of Life as if it were his wife Izzy in the present. In this timeline, Tommy escorts the tree, his wife, to a dying star, Xibalba.
It explains the creation myth. You see, that's first father. He's the very first human.
Ooh, is he dead?
He sacrificed himself to make the world. That's the Tree of Life bursting out of his stomach. His body became the tree's roots. They spread and formed the earth. His soul became the branches rising up, forming the sky. All that remained was first father's head. His children hung it in the heavens, creating Xibalba.
The cosmological problem Aronofsky is confronting in The Fountain is mortality. His main character Tommy is trying to solve the problem of death, calling it a disease. Tommy's linear pursuit of immortality is another allusion to the idea that man can re-enter the Garden of Eden. Another narrative pattern that emerges in Aronofsky's work is the story of the hostile brothers, or Cain and Abel. Cain, the firstborn son of Adam and Eve, is jealous and resentful toward his younger brother Abel, whose offerings to God are more favored than his. Cain murders Abel in a crime of passion, and is punished by God to a life of wandering. Cain's jealousy and resentment form the foundations of this character pattern, which can be observed in nearly every great villain and antagonistic character. This is what makes the Hostile Brothers an archetypal story, because it has continued to play out across the aeons and has a home in the psyche of every person. In Aronofsky's adaptation of the biblical story of Noah, the Hostile Brothers plays out through the character of Tubal Cain, a direct descendant of Cain, who shows up with an army to try and take Noah's ark from him.
I give life. I take life away, as you do. And I am like you, am I not? Speak to me.
Flood myths are found in nearly all mythological canon. They transcend geography, time, and culture. They typically find their form in creation myths, which serve to explain how the world came into being. On a transpersonal level, flood myths represent the inevitable destruction of civilization due to the inherent corruption and destructiveness of culture. On a more psychological level, submergence is a highly symbolic theme found in dreams and stories. Oftentimes, an encounter with water in a dream or a story is indicative of something of psychological importance being discovered in the unconscious. When used in storytelling, water and submergence can represent the bringing up of information from the deep, dark, unconscious psyche. Oftentimes, the encounter with water is necessary in order for some mystery about the self to be uncovered and for transformation to occur. In Noah, the flood represents man's understanding of his own capacity for destruction and evil. This is communicated to Noah, not directly from God, but through visions and dreams. Noah understands that the floodwaters will rise to cleanse the world of man. A fatal reminder that the experiment of civilization is incredibly fragile and can go off the rails at any moment. In Aronofsky's most recent film, Mother, all three of these biblical narrative patterns emerge in a sequence together and form the structure of the first half of the film. The story begins with Mother and him living in a large, isolated house. He, played by Javier Bardem, is likened more to the divine Logos than God himself. And Mother, played by Jennifer Lawrence, is likened more to the divine feminine, creativity, wisdom, and nature. These two characters are the archetypal world parents, Father Culture and Mother Nature. He is a poet who creates using the word. She is his wife, but is also deeply connected to the house, and is the house, and the house is the world. The Great Mother is the source of all creativity, and she provides for and nurtures him. One evening, a man arrives, played by Ed Harris, who represents Adam. Adam and him immediately begin to bond through conversation, alienating Mother. After one of Adam's ribs is removed, a woman shows up, Eve, played by Michelle Pfeiffer. Adam and Eve immediately begin encroaching upon Mother, and her relationship with her house and her husband rapidly deteriorates.
I told you, he doesn't like anyone being in here without him.
It's amazing. What is it?
We really have to leave.
The two are told explicitly never to enter his office or to go near his most prized possession. Just like Adam and Eve in the garden, it's one of the first things they do. The two break his fragile glass heart, and they're told to leave his office, a representation for the Garden of Eden, the place of original creation.
Hey, who are you?
Who are you? What are you doing here?
What are any of us doing here, right?
Adam and Eve's sons arrive. Cain, played by Domhnall Gleeson, and his younger brother, Abel, played by Brian Gleeson. The two sons squabble over petty financial concerns, which eventually leads Cain to murder his brother out of pure passion.
Get up! Get up! Stop thinking! Get up!
A cindering hole in the floor forms in the place where Cain commits this murder. As the family mourns the loss of their son, Mother's house begins to fill with more and more people, each becoming increasingly more obnoxious, thoughtless, and thankless.
It's really okay. Stop doing that. Don't do that. Stop. Stop doing that. Aronofsky seems to have completed a narrative pattern that began at the outset of his career, starting with the dawn of consciousness, confrontations with mortality and suffering, eventually culminating in discoveries about the human capacity for good and evil and our relationship with our environment. He uses these biblical narrative patterns as a means of grounding his films in a kind of firm, immovable archetype that goes beyond merely helping to tell the story of a hero's journey. This method of storytelling, coupled with his technical mastery and visionary directing, is what gives his films the kind of emotional weight and spiritual thrust that leaves viewers uniquely affected and confounded by the experience. Aronofsky didn't write The Wrestler or Black Swan, but those films are evidence to the fact that he's far from done directing amazing films. But it's hard to try and predict where Aronofsky will go next as a writer. He seems to have closed the loop on the ancient biblical stories, so I think it's anyone's guess as to what he will do next.